Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The peace and blessings of God Almighty upon you all, and welcome yet again to another episode of the IBSA seminar series. IBSA seminar series thus far have been addressing very pertinent issues relating to the Muslim community here in our country itself, in South Africa, different regions, as well as its relevance to a more global context, and especially to the Muslim world. Of those important areas that we have been discussing and addressing during the IBSA seminar series have been the phenomenon of ISIS, the whole concept of caliphate, but also the complexities of the geopolitical agendas at play in the Muslim world. But more, all the while as well, trying to navigate our ways and try to find sort of more common middle way responses, middle road responses to all of this, as hopefully guidance to ourselves as well as to our viewers and the Muslim community in particular. And as always, we have special guests joining us for our programs, and today is no exception. We have with us again Sheikh Fakhruddin Al-Uwaisi, the chairperson of the Sunni Ulama Council here in the Western Cape, as well as a lecturer at the International Peace College, South Africa. Sheikh Fakhruddin, once again, welcome to the program. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ahlan wa sahlan. Marhaba. Sheikh Fakhruddin, I think today we would like to focus a little bit more on a sort of more positive, as well as perhaps a kind of directive and advisory kind of approach to discussion of or to our community, and especially the youth in our community, of how to obviously consider these areas that are pertinent in our community, as we've just mentioned. And I think for us as Muslims living in our country, it is just so important for us to remember that Muslims living in South Africa have a comparatively very favorable situation and set of circumstances that we enjoy by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Alhamdulillah.
Obviously, we understand that people, given the investment that they make into society, given the investment that they make obviously in their communities, they will find the commensurate outcomes. In a sense, what you plant is what you will harvest. Mm-hmm. In a sense. Mm-hmm. And so by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we find that there's a relative good sense of confidence in the Muslim community here in South Africa. We have a relative good sense of wonderful and peaceful coexistence, for example, with our fellow citizens in our country. We have a wonderful sense of ownership of our own identities as very proud South African Muslims. And this, I think, is something very positive, because this, for me, represents the very essence of, being Muslim, the very essence of Islam, and that is to be able to, interact with society, with people, at a human level, and making contribution to society, with very specific reference to this, to the very relevant needs of society. And so we found that since 350 years, existence of a community here in this country, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is a very positive, it is a very favorable story that can be held up as a model, really, for many communities in different parts of the world. I think, Sheikh Fakhruddin, today, what we'd like to do more then is to ask ourselves, so how do we build on this? What are the kind of things that really, in essence, from, again, Islamic normative as well as an Islamic sort of guidance perspective, what are those areas that we believe we ought to structure within our community, the social structures, the community structures, the cultural norms and social cultural norms, as well as those religious cultural norms that will further consolidate but also reinforce this wonderful positive context that we enjoy here in South Africa. Mm-hmm.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalam ala Sayyidina Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man walaha. Amma ba'd, I also greet all the viewers. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. To Alhamdulillah to all of you here in South Africa and all over Africa and all over the world. May the peace and blessings of Allah be with you all. Alhamdulillah, we are South African, we are in this beautiful country. And we need to take more pride in that, and we need to realize that from a very deeply spiritual point of view, there is a deep hikmah and wisdom where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places you. He places you where He wants you to be. Maqamak haythu aqamak. You know, your job is where He placed you. So I think this what we see nowadays is this Middle Easternization of Islam. You know, that we kind of like belong in the Middle East. We all belong in the Middle East. We all need to be concerned about the Middle East. I think that this whole, it's a false notion. We don't belong in the Middle East, you know. It's not our responsibility to solve the problems of the Middle East, you know. And that's not our home, you know. We need to, you know, realize where are our priorities, you know. It's not this obsession with Middle East and Iraq. Islam does not belong in Iraq or Syria or Saudi Arabia or anywhere. Islam is for all lands. And for me, my Islam is here in South Africa. And my service to Islam is going to be here in South Africa, because this is where I am and this is where I need to serve, unless you think that there is no need for any service for Islam here. No, there is so much to be done here for Islam in this land, that why should I then go to another country and try to serve Islam there? So I think that itself is very nationalistic. It's interesting that people who want to talk about Khilafah and stuff are sometimes very much promoting Arab nationalism in a way, because their whole ideology just revolves around the Arab world and those territories, and uprooting Muslims from territories where they have brought Islam. Our forefathers, our ancestors, yes, spiritual leaders, they, alhamdulillah, brought Islam to this furthest corner of Africa. You, Mr. ISIS, is telling me that we have to uproot that and go back to somewhere where we didn't even come from, to Iraq or Syria, because that's what they're calling, right? Everybody should just migrate there. And how can we forget the toil and then the sacrifices and the hard work our forefathers have done to establish the Deen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this part of this far, far off land, and throw all that away to go join some sectarian conflict in Iraq or Syria or wherever else? No, sorry, we're not going to do that, you know. And we believe our jihad, our struggle for Islam and the principles of Islam, of service to mankind, is here. So we need to realize that we have to serve Islam. Firstly, you know, where we are situated, you know, Al-Jar, you know, they have the first right on you. So here in this country, we have major problems. Firstly, the Muslims are a minority here, so there's a majority of the population of this country that is not Muslim, first of all. So we have millions of human beings in South Africa who do not know anything about Islam. Our first duty is to take the message of Islam to them, because our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was ultimately sent to preach Islam to people, not to enforce a form of government, not to enforce certain forms of punishments, you know, cutting hands, and not to enforce certain types of rituals or appearances. He was sent for and foremost to proclaim the oneness of God and to invite people to God. And we have millions of people who need to be done there. Secondly, besides that, there are millions of people in this country who are hungry and poor and needy and disadvantaged. And as Muslims, you know, we have a duty towards them as well, towards the poor. Our Prophet Muhammad was the exemplar for all mankind in that, in helping the poor and the disadvantaged. So there is so much to be done in this land. So
his primary sort of appellation or attribute that Allah Subhanahu wa Taala gives him, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ.
Yes, Allah says, "O Muhammad, we have sent you as a mercy for all mankind." So my question to anybody who wants to thinks of even joining ISIS or going overseas is, what have you done to establish Islam in your own homeland that you want to run away and try to establish some form of Islam in some Middle Eastern country? You know, you're running away from your own job, you know. If you want to talk about establishing Islam, then you're running away from where you're supposed to be doing that and working for the deen. And it's interesting that the Prophet Muhammad himself, when things were bad in the Middle East, he sent his companions to Africa. And they had sometimes the most exemplary Muslim community in Africa under the rule of a Christian king.
Under a Christian king.
Yeah.
Under whose rule nobody would be oppressed.
That's what the Prophet said, that he is a Christian, but people are not oppressed under his rule. So we need to realize that we are answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, for what happens in our own country.
So the Prophet even identified there the freedom with which the Muslims will be able to pursue their conscience and practice their faith.
Exactly.
As opposed to today, if you look at that part of the world, yes. The establishment of an ISIS, yes. There is no such freedom.
There is no such freedom, really, yes. So what is the purpose of establishing a khilafah in the first place? You know, let's say we agree on that. What's the purpose of having this Islamic mm-hmm. state? Mm-hmm. Is that a goal in itself, that Muslims should just have a government and rule the world? No. It's a means. Means to what? Means to take forward the message of Islam. Now, we as South African Muslims, we don't even need that means. We are already situated in a place where we can take the message of Islam forward without the need for any such violence or any such state or whatever. So even if there is a need for that, that's a problem of the Middle East. It's not really we are already placed in a position to do what Islam is all about, which is take the message forward. So people who are running away from that, basically, they're running after the means while sacrificing the actual purpose. And so it's really a dichotomy,
And in a sense, Sheikh, obviously that message of Islam, as you've said, from a pure theological basis, obviously, Islam is a faith which has a missionary purpose.
Yes.
Like religions and yes. faiths of other persuasions.
Yes, yes, yes.
It has a missionary purpose. So we have to proclaim the message. We have to pronounce the message of the oneness of Allah Almighty, of the Prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the pre or the framework rather of that message, we're talking about service to humanity,
yes,
safeguarding humanity, bringing yes. of course that which is beneficial for humanity,
yes,
as
yes.
Prophet peace be upon him says that the most meritorious and praised of all of you in the sight of God Almighty are those who are most beneficial to humanity.
Naam.
And so, as you've said very correctly then, yeah, in a South African context, we're able to pursue those ideals. We're able to pursue those values. We are perfectly situated. And in fact, we probably would be under a higher standard of accountability and responsibility precisely because the circumstances are so well placed for us.
Yes, so I mean, it would make actually more sense if people from Iraq or Syria actually migrated to South Africa to assist in the da'wah of Islam here. You know, that would make more sense than somebody going there and leaving what he has to hold on to and continue building and taking Islam forward in this land, as well as a message of peace and guidance to broken hearts and broken souls in this country. We have a spiritual drought in South Africa. People are feeling oppressed outwardly and inwardly, and we have the solutions, I believe, outwardly and inwardly. Economically, our community has solutions, outwardly speaking, helping the people uplift the communities economically. Spiritually, we have this beautiful deen to share. So why would anybody want to leave? If the Prophet ﷺ, was alive today physically, he would be here. He would want to come here. And Allah mahini miskin and amitni, in the hadith where the Nabi ﷺ said, "Oh Allah, oh Allah, make me live amongst the poor and the oppressed, yes. and make me die amongst the poor and the oppressed, yes. and raise me up amongst the poor and the oppressed." So even the idea of having an Islamic state that makes jihad apparently and fights other nations, that was particularly, especially because in those days, those other empires that were there at that time, the Roman and Persian empires, they had prohibited the spreading of Islam in their lands. Islam was not allowed to be preached peacefully in their lands at all. And if anybody was a Muslim, would be killed and so on. So that's why the Muslims at that time had to fight those empires to establish religious freedom in those lands. That's why when the Muslims conquered those territories, they didn't force Islam on the people. They let the Persians follow their religion, the Zoroastrians, the Majus, and there were debates on jizya and stuff. The Christians, even till the Crusades, the Christians remained a kind of a majority in Syria and Palestine and many of these countries. The Muslims never forced them. They just said, now that we Muslims rule your territories, there will be freedom of religion. So that our du'at, our missionaries, can preach Islam peacefully to you. So people came in peacefully to Islam. So even the idea of making jihad against another country, it's not to just subjugate people politically, and but to open the doors of Islam spreading there, not being forced. But the point is, here in South Africa, that's already there. We don't need nothing like that. The religious freedom is already there. Nobody is stopping you from propagating Islam. So why do we then want to leave these opportunities? And the same goes, I would say, for England and people who are watching overseas or wherever other many countries that are there. Why do you want to leave a perfect place for da'wah and preaching, bringing people to Allah and serving mankind to be part of killing and violence, which is basically Muslim on Muslim for all that matters in any case, You know, nobody is killing any enemy of Islam. So I think it's more of an obsession with the Middle Eastern politics that has we have been brainwashed into by media and stuff. Mm. You know, and whoever is the enemy of certain Middle Eastern powers becomes our enemy. Mm. Whoever is their friend, it becomes our friend, and their problems become our problems. Mm. So we have to be very careful with that. We have a divinely endowed responsibility where we are, and we can't neglect that. Yes.
The original position of humankind, God created, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created humankind.
Yes.
He created them with that freedom of conscience.
Yes.
They should not be forced to believe in any other way except that which brings conviction to their own consciences.
Yes.
And so obviously, I mean, that how can you force somebody to believe something?
Yes, you can't. You know, hypocrisy is...
It's just contradictory. And so... from that perspective, from the essence and the original position and the principle and the foundations in our faith is that Muslims and people of all faiths live together in peace, together peacefully.
Yes.
And they live together in order also to build and to develop society and to develop civilization, so that the conditions of human beings can be improved around them.
Yes.
And so the whole notion of the development of those who are underprivileged, those who are downtrodden, those who are the poor and the needy, those are the, from our perspective, not just personal or cultural, but it's religious responsibilities for us to look, of course, towards the advancement and the progress of humanity. The whole notion even of, you know, and this is something I think which we sometimes, you know, the lines get blurred. You know, when it reminds me when the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, went to Mecca at the time to leave, one of the trials that Allah Almighty subjected him to was to leave his baby boy with his wife in this barren valley called Mecca. And there was no one there. And then he says, well, Allah, you know, turn this place and grant this place to be a place of security.
No.
It's a place which is safe. Amen. And then he says, and grant its inhabitants, you know, grant them abundant provision and grant them rizq, which is abundant for them. And then Prophet Abraham said, those who believe in you. Yeah? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a sense, amends his dua and he says, and those who do not believe.
Yes.
I will give them the same provisions.
Yes.
I will give them the same security. I'll give them the safe safety in this world. Obviously, again, the whole idea of if there is a judgment, if there is accountability for humankind in terms of their relationship vis-a-vis the Creator, all of that happens in the hereafter.
Now,
the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will determine that on the day of judgment.
Yes.
And so inter se among human beings, we are not judges, we are not arbiters of one another or over one another.
Yes.
On the contrary, we live here in order to ensure that our mutual benefits, our mutual masalih are confirmed and that they are established. Sheikh, what are some of the things that, you know, we ought to, as a Muslim community, be focusing on in order to achieve these wonderful and noble ideals in society, especially as far as young people are concerned, especially as far as the... you know, the development and the advancement of those, as we've indicated now, those values and those ideals of Islam are concerned.
Yeah, no, really, you know, I mean, the Prophet ﷺ lived in Medina, Mecca, and then he moved to Medina. In Mecca, him and the Muslims were an oppressed minority, but never once did he, you know, propagate terrorism or propagate assassinations. It's like he didn't tell Sayyidina Umar, you know, and go kill Abu Jahl in the night when he's sleeping, or go kill Abu Lahab or Umayyah and all these people, Abu Sufyan. He didn't do that, you know, he just told them to have sabr. He didn't tell them, okay, when they're all sleeping, go destroy their idol. You know, he could have done that to show that, no, you don't deal like that. When he went to Medina as well, the first thing he did was he met with the people who were not Muslims in Medina, the Jews and the other non-Muslims. And he drafted the constitution of Medina, Wasiqat al-Madina, where he gave them full rights. I mean, I urge everybody to read that document. It's document of our Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, historical document, where he said that Jews will have the same rights as Muslims. They are free to follow their religion. No Muslim will touch their holy books. No Muslim will touch their places of worship. No Muslim will be allowed to insult their prophets. And likewise from their side to the Muslims, and no Muslim will be allowed to interfere with their trading in their own areas and so on. And them and a Muslim will be equal in front of the law. You know, a Muslim will not have any superior right over them. This is the first thing he did. So it shows you that his whole idea was not to force anybody, but to preach Islam actually by showing them the justice of Islam, the equality of Islam. So that is the ethos of our Prophet ﷺ. Our Prophet actually never had any intention of ruling over anybody. Even when he became the ruler of Medina, it was kind of a spin-off or a perk of being the Prophet, because he was the Prophet, so automatically majority of the Medinans were Muslim by that time. So by him being the Prophet, the person they obey, he automatically kind of became the ruler. But he had no intention for mulk, of being a kingdom, of being a king or a kingdom or ruling over anything like that. In Makkah, he was offered the chiefdom and he refused it. When he wrote his letters to the different kings calling them to Islam, he even wrote in those letters, accept Islam and you can remain king over your land. I don't like your dynasty can continue ruling. I'm not interested in that. So we have to get this obsession of world domination out of our heads. Islam is about self-domination. And we don't want to dominate the world politically, we want to dominate the world spiritually and ethically and morally and socially. Right now, we are failing in those aspects, but we want to dominate politically, you know, and that's not going to help. For us in South Africa, I think we need to focus more on spiritual and social activities. Much more needs to be done in utilizing our youth, especially the ones in the corporate world, the ones that are working and so on, in helping the poor and the oppressed. You know, I cannot prescribe the mechanisms and dynamics for that right now, but every masjid should have a soup kitchen for the poor people in the areas, and not just giving them the fish, but teaching them how to fish, you know. Every Muslim doctor or lawyer should be, I mean, offering at least some free, you know, assistance or tuition, you know, ideally, I'm talking about ideals here now, you know, to many poor people in his own area or other areas. And I know there are some who are doing it. I mean, there are some Muslim, the media and doesn't highlight these people. Correct. There are Muslim doctors associations and stuff who go out there in those areas and then are there free of charge to help and tuition kids. And then, so, but it's very little. It's not proportionate to what the amount of professionals we have. We need to, even our religious youth, those who are in the religious line, should be, you know, encouraged in the direction of social work. Even in our own community, we've got drug problems, major drug problems, we have major social problems, you know. So this needs to be done. Also, I mean, there needs to be a revival of spirituality in our youth. The youth, by nature, are rebellious and full of energy. And if it's that energy is not directed in the right direction, then it can go in the wrong direction. So we need to have a revival of spirituality. A lot of this is happening because of a lack of spirituality. To realize that Islam ultimately is a spiritual way of life. Islam is a spiritual order. In Islam, every Muslim is supposed to be a saint. It's not like in other religions where there are the few saints and everybody else can just carry on with normal life. In Islam, by definition, every Muslim is supposed to be a waliullah, to be a friend of Allah, a saint and a saintly person. So there also needs to be, our understanding of the deen also needs to become a little bit more in depth. And this comes from the clergy. So I want to call on the clergy here, the ulama basically, that you also need to delve a bit more deeper into Islam itself, improve your knowledge, you know, grow on your knowledge, read more, read from different scholars, read from scholars from other than your school of thought, for example, read from even people from other religions, you know, read generally and widen your worldview so that you can get a bigger picture of what's happening as well. So that our ulama then can also intellectually lead our youth in the right direction. Now what's happening is many of our scholars intuitively know that ISIS and these organizations and what they are doing is wrong, but unfortunately they are not being able to convince some of the youth. I mean, we know now that some of these ISIS recruiters in South Africa, they've got study circles where they've been studying for, at one report that I had, was that they've been studying certain booklets promoting the ISIS Khawarij mentality for over a year. So when these youth go and debate with our scholars don't know how to answer them because they are not well read. They're not aware of what's happening. And we need to understand, the situation, get a deeper understanding of what's happening as well. The message of tolerance and peace and love for our nation and accountability for our own country first also needs to come from the member. Sometimes, unfortunately, from many of our members, sometimes it's not even intentional, but the message that comes is one of gloom and doom. In other words, there is no hope for our country, and things are just bad and getting worse. And you know, so then don't blame the youth after that. If some youngsters feel, I should better for me if I migrate to, financially better if I migrate to New Zealand, spiritually better if I migrate to ISIS. So both of this, we need to cut out on that, running after finance or running after what we perceive to be better off religiously, and realize that financially and spiritually, our work is here in South Africa, and we need to improve our and other people's conditions spiritually, financially, politically in this land. We've been part of the struggle here, our communities, and the struggle is not over yet. So we still have to be part of that, and Allah is pleased with that.
Sheikh Fakhreddin, I think that's all we have time left for this evening. I think it's wonderful just to remind ourselves about the importance of having those causes that we link ourselves to, these higher causes, these higher values, and the higher ideals of our faith.
Yes.
And of course, as you've indicated very, very pertinently, in order to pursue those causes from the Islamic perspective and point of view, there needs to be also a heightened sense of spiritual connectedness to the Creator.
Yes.
And so serving the Creator by also being in the service of his creation. And I think this is the essence of Islam. And again, as you've alluded to, the circumstances and the context that we enjoy here in our country lends itself for us to become really
true khalifas of Allah.
True khalifas.
Spiritual khalifa. Everybody is a khalifa of Allah on this earth. That is the real khilafa.
100%. Sheikh, thank you very much once again for a wonderful discussion. Until we see one another once again, perhaps on the program, I hope, inshallah. We also have no time, but rather just to leave with a word of greetings to our listeners and our viewers. Thank you for joining us on yet again another seminar series, the IBSA seminar series. Until we speak to one another again, I greet you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and blessings of God Almighty be with you all.